Welcome back to Lost Wolf's Notes. I'm going to talk a little bit more in depth about choosing your game because that's a fairly serious topic and I wanted to spend a little bit of time on it because I didn't do a lot about it last time. So this is not going to be it's not going to be about nitty-gritty. It's not going to be about, you know, which games you should choose and shouldn't choose. Theoretically, you can choose anything. But I'm going to talk a little bit about how to go about picking what you want to play. So, we've got the table of contents here, we got the two types of LP, which I'll get to in a second, talking about what to do leading up to and using the information I'm giving you here for your first LP. I've got some thoughts about session length and some genre thoughts, and then there's some generalities that you might want to bear in mind when you're going into your first LP. And then we're going to talk a little bit about your second LP and beyond. So, there are two types of LP. The first kind of LP style is the walkthrough style, and this is the style that most of you are probably going to be interested in pursuing. In the walkthrough style, you see and do everything for the most part. There are some people who don't do that. That's okay. A lot of this is about getting through the game. It's great for a first game, and I'll talk about why in a minute or two, but it is great because it's familiar, okay? It's also great if you know the game well, in a sense that it will lead you towards being able to complete the game, because it's something you know that you can tackle and have finished. It's also great if you're terrible at patter. I'm horrible at patter, so I talk about the game a lot, and that's one of my shortcomings as an LPer. But that's just a style I'm used to and work with. But if you're terrible at patter, knowing what you're doing in the game and being able to explain it is also great. So the second style is blind style. I've never seriously pursued a blind style of LP, but the idea here is that you've never played the game before and you want to show it off and show off your reactions to the game. That's the thing. It's all about capturing your reactions to what's going on in the game. The problem, of course, is that it's, by contrast with the walkthrough style, not really exhaustive, because again, you know, you don't know the game, so you're just going to pick up what you can and make do with what you get. If you can do patter, this can be fantastic. If you're the kind of guy who can light up a room by saying a couple of words, or the kind of lady who knows exactly how to make people enjoy your voice by singing or whatever, then this is great for you because it allows your patter to run free and wild, okay? The thing about your first LP, and once you start planning your first LP, the first thing you have to consider is session length. And this is fairly important because this will dictate almost everything else that comes afterwards. But the thing that's most important here is remember that you're being allowed into someone else's house. They're clicking on your video and they're saying, for 20 minutes or whatever, show me what you're doing, show me what you're up to. Don't overstay your welcome. That's the important thing. 15 to 20 minutes, good baseline, especially when you're starting out and your audience don't know you and they just want to see what you're up to. One thing I'm going to suggest is don't change this midstream. If you're running an LP and an LP has like a fixed time budget of, say, you know, 15 minutes per session, don't suddenly go changing that unless something happens in the game that forces you to do that. Or unless you warn your viewers beforehand that you're going to do that. I've been a little bit guilty of this because I hadn't LP'd Police Quest 3 for a long time, so I figured it would only be fair to give my audience a big chunk of Police Quest 3 because I hadn't. So, you know, my suggestion is keep it at a length where people know what they're going to get into whenever they're seeing that video pop up. The next thing is, it's a big thing, and it runs across three slides, but the idea is that I'm going to talk a little bit about genre thoughts and things that you should be aware of when you're playing these games. With action games, we're talking like shooting games, first person and third person shooters and that kind of thing. Don't get caught up in the game. Remember, you're there to entertain to some degree, so you must be able to keep talking no matter what's going on with you in the game. if you're playing something like a Zelda or the like, remember that those are collectathons, and if you're going to collect something like the Skull Tellers, make sure you have a list so you don't inadvertently go back and try and get something that you've already gotten. For action adventure, I'm going to say that this is a little bit different than just straight up action. There will be light puzzles. Be ready for the puzzles. If you encounter the puzzle, make sure that you can get through the puzzle without stumbling. I'm going to talk about that in a minute with actual adventure games, but no one likes watching people get stuck. Unless it's funny and rage-inducing, then maybe. If you're playing an action-adventure also, like, for example, if you're playing the original Legend of Zelda for the NES, make sure you have maps. Again, getting lost is not something people want to see, unless it turns out to be funny. For adventure, for those of you who've watched Kung Pao, you might know the word badong. It's bad and wrong. Getting stuck is badong. Don't do that. If you do get stuck and you eventually solve the problem, edit out what happens in between. If it's just you trying every item on every other item, unless it's funny or unless you do something silly and it would be able to generate entertainment with the people who are watching, don't keep that stuff in. If you are going to do adventure games, make sure that you use a walkthrough, because again, no one likes watching you get stuck. You need to also, or the alternative is learn the game very well. When I did King's Quest 1, I had played that game through for a long time, and I'd done 8 or 9 run-throughs already in the past, so I knew it quite well. And that is how you would approach that. For MMOs, MMOs are a big kettle of fish, and you have to be careful of them. You need a script, and you need to be ready for what you're going to do with the game. Remember that because it's an MMO, because it's so big, you can't see everything, and you can't show everything off. So, for example, if you're in a zone, complete the zone, but don't go to like the same level range zone that you've been through already. And know that there will be seasonal events and that kind of thing that you can't necessarily show off, so don't worry about that. Show people what interests you in the MMO. If that's dungeon runs, stick to dungeon runs, or raids, or PvP, or whatever. Make it so that it is exhaustive within its sort of genre, unless you're doing what I'm doing, like I'm doing World of Warcraft as if though you would be playing it. And in that case, I'm trying to show you as much as I can at the level range that we're at. For RPGs, what you almost certainly want to do is edit out the tedium. No one wants to watch that. If you get into a fight, make sure that you have a list of monsters that you keep with you. And if you see a monster that you've already fought, cross it off the list. Don't record that fight. The management stuff means managing your inventory, managing your party, managing the level ups, unless they're big events like collecting a legendary item or a particular level up like level 60 and that's the end of the leveling, maybe show that. Or if you're getting a new perk and you want to demonstrate how the perk works, that kind of thing, keep that in. But general leveling up, you might not want to keep all of that in. So, these three here are, I'm going to say, things that you might want to avoid, especially at first play. Simulation games can be very difficult to watch for people who are not into simulation games. They absolutely need patter. So if you're going to play, for example, The Sims 2, you need to actually have your patter at hand to explain what's going on or to talk about anything that isn't the game, usually. The other thing I'm going to suggest about simulation, I didn't put it on yet, I should actually put it in there, is have a cutoff point. If you're playing The Sims, for example, say once your sim reaches 1,000 simoleons in terms of their money that they're earning in a job, that's a cutoff point, because otherwise those games can just go on forever. With strategy games, your audience can get lost very easily in a strategy game unless you explain the rules, so make sure that you do that up front. Also, the other thing about simulation games to be wary of is that they can drag, because like if it's a turn-based strategy game, the fights might take a long time, and that kind of thing. And you need to be wary of that. For vehicle simulation, they can be completely relaxing. Like, if you're going to do Euro Truck Simulator or something like that, that can be fantastically relaxing to watch, but you need patter for that, you know? Unless you're just going to do, like, silent drives, where you're showing off beautiful parts of the country in that game. That can be a thing that you could do. So once you've got your first LP, and once you're busy planning it out, I want to tell you that you should probably play something that you know very well. And I keep making this point, and the reason why I made it a couple of times already is because with playing your first LP that you know very well, it can be very freeing, because you can either talk about the game, which you know quite well, or not, as you see fit. So it can be great for developing patter. Familiarity, I find, also helps with confidence. If you are not used to talking to people, playing the game that you know will set you up on the road to confidence, because you'll get through the game and go, oh well, that wasn't so hard, and then you'll pick something a little bit more obscure out of your library and play that and go with that. I see a lot of advice on the internet about worrying about doing something that's overdone, like Minecraft or Pokemon or whatever. My advice, don't worry about it. At this point in LPing, there are so many people doing so many different things that it's okay for you to go ahead and do a game that you already know has been done to death. Because remember, your first LP is not about... it's about building an audience, but that's not your main goal, shouldn't be your main goal in your first LP. Your first LP should be, I am getting to feel comfortable doing this. I am learning the ropes of how to edit, of how to get my video uploaded to YouTube, and how to distribute it through social media. It's about getting a pipeline sorted out so that when you go to record, you know exactly the process that you're going to follow to get to upload and then to share. For your second LP and beyond, the sky is basically the limit, but what I would suggest that you're doing while you're busy ending off your first project, make a list of follow-up projects that you're curious about doing, and start working on them a little bit before you start doing the new you start ending the first project, okay? The other thing is, start developing a schedule. You're going to want to make sure that people know that you're doing this and such on a specific day. Now, at the moment, I'm breaking all of the rules that I'm setting for you here, because at the moment I'm in disarray, because it's December of 2015 for those of you in the future. So I'm not sticking to my schedule, but by the time January rolls around, we will have a new schedule and we will stick to it. I say this again because, remember, you're letting people you are being let into people's house, and you are entertaining them. And if they know kind of what to expect on kind of what day, if they're watching you and they're setting up their life around, you know, a half an hour break where they can watch some YouTube and they think about watching you, then they know what to expect when they're watching you. So, like, for example, if Monday to Friday is adventures, you know, like playing adventure games, then they will know, okay, if they're not into adventure games, they don't watch during the week, but on Saturday and Sunday you do, like, let's say a collectathon, they will then tune in and they can watch, and that's great for them. Remember, you are entertaining users, your audience, and also you are being allowed into their houses. So make sure that they're going to enjoy the time that they spend with you. That's it. That's all for this particular set of slides. So, I hope that you've derived some useful information from this. Again, if you want more, please keep talking to me about it. We'll keep going. I will see you whenever I do another one of these. Have a great day, folks, and goodbye.